transformation went almost equally fundamentally is the asymptotic distribution of the singular values rather than rectangular matrices, known as the Marchenko-Marchenko distribution. Thus, it is a matter of great honor and pleasure to welcome academician Leonid Andreevich Pastur to our institute during the Golden Jubilee celebrations. I crave your indulgence while I say a few words about our illustrious visitor. After graduating from secondary school, he entered the Faculty of Physics and Engineering in the Kharkov Polytechnic Institute. After graduating from the institute, Pastur began working at the Institute for Low Temperature Physics and Engineering, or ILTPE of the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine, the Department of Mathematical Physics, headed by Academician B.A. Marchenko. In 1964, Pastur defended his PhD thesis, and in 65 his DSA thesis. Problems in the theory of disordered systems was his thesis. From 1988, he headed the Department of Statistical Methods in Mathematical Physics at the ILTPE, and at present he is the head of the Department of Theoretical Physics, same institute. So I don't want to go on down a list of various honors, so I'll just say that a couple of things. There's a monograph by Lipschitz, Spool, and Pastur for Introduction to the Theory of Disordered Systems, which was awarded the State Prize of Ukraine in 1985. In 1990, he was elected an academician for the National Academy of
matter, both experimental and theoretical, but we are doing also biophysics and last but not least, we have a quite serious mathematical division in which we are doing math. We have had, unfortunately, even our own Fields Medalist, Vladimir Brinfield, who left with many other young people who left Ukraine, unfortunately. And because of this multidisciplinarity of both institutions, I hope that my talk, which is roughly 50-50 mathematical physics probability and we'll see what else, and will be quite to the point. And I have picked about large random matrices, which is now quite fashionable subject, despite that. A bit acquainted with the subject, you see it's a simple story, just you do probability with not scalar random variables, but matrix, but with matrix valued random variables. And it was like that in the early 30s when random matrices appeared first in statistics in multivariate analysis, but then eventually they are almost everywhere, as you can see from this next slide, which is a kind of publicity, but I'm quite humble presenting subject because they are much more numerous. So I will not comment too much about the list because about each item of this list you can say a lot. I just would like to say that you can wonder why there are so many apparently different subjects. And the reason, more or less simple, because whenever you see, and there are many fields when you see, when you see a matrix, an operator, whose property you do not know too well, you try to think about what a typical property. So it's a kind of a combination of typicality and other said a combination of black box. If you do not know what a particular property of your operator, of your matrix, you try to write something random, hoping that you'll find some property. And this is just common things in probabilistic approach in general. And we yesterday even, have heard that Professor Gross mentioned that even so refined field is analytic number theory, uses successfully this approach, typicality, randomness, etc. And there is one more reason, also not so hard to feel, that we are dealing with multidimensional integrals, with matrix integrals. And we know that even just standard one-dimensional integral, by using this, you can represent a lot of things, quite complicated. So no question that if you write matrix integral with very many variables, you hope to describe a lot of things. And this is just a part, this point of view, just a part of point of view, which is a kind of definition of statistical mechanics, which is this quite universal science about everything that you see. Well, and now the outline of my talk, I have chosen not all the possible subjects that are here, but just a part, which is, in my opinion, quite representative. So I'll speak about the validity of central limit theorem, which is a kind of cornerstone of probabilistic approach. And we are going to see that there are cases when we have central limit theorem, there are cases when but in the setting, which is quite unusual from the point of view of conventional probability, we have a situation in which the central limit is not valid. And at the end, I will mention just a bit another topic related, but not precisely the same, which we call universality. Well, what is a general setting? We have just a sequence. For any given integer n, we have a matrix, real symmetric or Hermitian, and we assume that the matrix is random. It's a simple story. You just assume that the entries of matrix are random variables, and there is a certain jargon already. So despite that we have a sequence of matrices, we say that we have a just random matrix, or even we have an ensemble. Don't mix, for in French, ensemble means set, just a set, but here it is just an old-fashioned understanding of probability. If you have a random variable, roughly you have an ensemble of samples, of trials, etc. And we are looking for just the most important part in random matrices is that you are interested not in entries. You are given entries, but you are interested in eigenvalues in eigenvectors. So these are notations that I'm going to use. And now we form a certain function of eigenvalues in eigenvectors. And just following statistic terminology, we call this the function by spectral statistics because it is in spectral terms. In particular, a quite important role plays so-called linear eigenvalue statistics. So just linear statistic, you take a function which we call test function again as in as statistics, and we write here the just this linear the sum of values, okay, and this is the analytic form and this is a matrix form. Is just you take a function phi, you can always compute find the a function of Hermitian or a real symmetric matrix, and you just take a trace of this matrix, yes? In particular, in an important case, if you take as a function phi, you just take an indicator of a certain set, an interval in simplest case of real axis, and in that case, the linear statistic is just the eigenvalue counting function, which is quite, respectable. Respected object of probability theory, and there is a lot of good math around the, for example, counting measure of Schrödinger operator or just a Laplacian operator in a bounded domain. This field exists since 1910s, and okay, I will not speak, but just it is similar thing. And the main question which we are trying to ask is what are, like in conventional probability, we are trying to ask to see what is the behavior of certain statistics, including linear eigenvalue statistics, for large n. So, at least in my opinion, random matrix theory is a asymptotic theory like probability to a large extent. This is not a universal point of view. For example, I know a colleague of mine, by the way, Indian origin, Mehta, who wrote a quite, archetypic book on random matrices. He used to say, I am about random matrices of finite size, as for large n, it's for you guys. So myself is from guys for which, from guys who likes asymptotic properties. And of course, given a function, for example, simplest possible function, linear statistics, you expect, again, recalling your knowledge of probability, that you may need certain normalization of these statistics. That means that you have to either subtract something or multiply the statistics by certain power of n of the size of matrix to if you would like to obtain certain limiting behavior, limiting law. Well, and let me just remind you a few elementary facts of probability theory. You have a sequence in simplest setting. You have a sequence, infinite sequence of independent identical distributed random variables with common probability law. You have a function again. You form again linear statistics, not eigenvalues, but just IID random variables. And there are two basic assertions in probability. The first is law of large numbers. If the expectation of each term is finite, then you have a law of large numbers. So you divide the statistics by n, you do, so to say, multiplicative renormalization. And then with probability 1, there is a limit of this random variable equals to the non-random limit, which is important. And this limit is given by this integral. Yeah, this is a law of large numbers. And the second fact, which is a kind of cornerstone of probabilistic approach in general, is the central limit theorem, provided that you have this property as well, and you do both. You do additive renormalization and certain, it's not a dot, this is just one half. And you divide by square root of n, then you can prove that this quantity converges this random variable converges to the Gaussian random variable and with zero mean, and whose variance is given by the variance of every term. And for what follows, it will be quite important. It will be important that the variance of the statistics, if you just renormalize by nothing, just as it is, the variance of your statistics grows as n for independent random variables. It grows as the size of your sample. And this will be discussed, mentioned many times. So these are simple facts from the probability. And then I'll discuss several cases when we have central limit theorem. The first case is a kind of archetype random matrix. Just, of course, if you're about something related to probability, of course, you start from Gaussian random variables. So we take a matrix, real symmetric matrix, which we used to write in that form, just putting in front of this factor, and then Wn, n by n, W in the honor of Wigner, who is one of the founding fathers of random matrix theory. And we have a real symmetric matrix, and we write its probability law in the form. So we write, of course, an analog of Lebesgue measure for matrices, and then the density with respect to this measure is given by this formula. And if you just recall that the trace of the square of matrix is written here, so you recognize immediately that your matrix has a simple property. All the entries, modulo symmetry condition, of course, are independent, and they are Gaussian random variables.
So you can write, instead of this complicated formula, you can write just two conditions. That you can say that they are independent, symmetric, and satisfy these conditions. And this is known as a Gaussian orthogonal ensemble. By the way, as I said, random matrix is just synonym of ensemble. And orthogonal, not because, you see, there are no orthogonal matrices here, but the probability law is invariant with respect to orthogonal transformation of matrix W. This is why we say that it is Gaussian orthogonal ensemble. And just a bit of warning that the problem is not going to be 100% simple, because we just take this distribution for 2 by 2 matrices. It could be written explicitly. And now you are, it is standard thing, your distribution is given in terms of entries, but you would like to compute something about eigenvalues, for example, eigenvectors, as I said before. So you just use spectral theorem for real symmetric matrices as a change of variables, and you can find the joint distribution of probability distribution of eigenvalues of these 2 by 2 matrix, lambda 1 and lambda 2, because they are explicitly written as functions of entries. So you just compute corresponding Jacobian, and you see that there is a term which is easy to preview. It is just trace of square written via eigenvalues. And here you have a factor which shows that your distribution is not a product of distribution for lambda 1 and lambda 2. There is a factor, roughly speaking, purely geometric, coming from the change of variables, from the fact that your matrix just symmetric, real symmetric matrix, that makes your variables strongly dependent, both on small and large distances between them. So we have to deal with the central limit theorem or whatever, with certain limit asymptotic analysis, but for strongly dependent random variables. And this is a crucial difference with standard probabilistic things.
You know, the simple example, in this case, eigenvalue repulsion.
Yeah, I'll come to repulsion later, yeah. You can see that one of, thanks a lot. So you can see that one of things that you see already on 2 by 2 matrices, that eigenvalue doesn't want to live close to one another. If lambda 1 close to lambda 2, the probability tends to 0. So somehow they repel one another. Okay, but nevertheless, despite that we have strongly dependent random variables, there is an analog of law of large numbers, which was first, roughly speaking, was argued by Wigner at the beginning of random matrix theory. And the formulation is like that. If your function, just an integrable function, and then you write linear statistics, you divide, of course, since you are looking for something like law of large numbers, you divide by the number of terms, and this limit, this random variable, because the matrix is random, eigenvalues are random, it converges with probability 1 to non-random limit given by linear function, by the integral of phi, and with respect to a certain measure, which is known as the semicircle or Wigner law. It was found first by Wigner, as I wrote here, in 52. By the way, the motivation of Wigner was quite, pragmatic, because he wanted to explain certain interesting new phenomena that were found in nuclear physics. And after a bomb, people had a lot of neutron spectra, or spectra of heavy nuclei, and they found that the spectra quite strange, and they have this property of repulsion. Eigenvalues with close so-called quantum numbers, they are not so likely. So Wigner tried to explain this by using random matrices in arguing, as I said at the beginning, we do not know what is a heavy nuclei. There are many things inside. There are, strong interaction. But because it is just black box, let's assume that corresponding Hamiltonian energy operator of your nuclei is just a random matrix, arbitrary, Gaussian distributed, just ad hoc. And he found this distribution. So we see now that it is a kind of analog of law of large numbers, of probability. And this measure is quite important. It will appear in the what follows not once. And it is just you take, you see, you take, I mentioned the measure already before. Let me show you. So if you take, here. So it is linear statistics for, it is defined for any phi, but if you take an indicator of set, you had the, this is, will be just counting measure. And the Wigner measure is just a limit, limit of this counting measure of eigenvalues. It is important that limit exists and it is not random. And okay, this is a basic quantity of random matrix theory. Now, having proved the law of large numbers, you try next step in probabilistic approach, because the limit is, since the limit is not random, you're asking what are fluctuations? If you change the scale, so you see if you divide the statistics by n, for large matrices, this sum doesn't fluctuate. It is almost not random. So I would like to, like in standard probability, you would like to change normalization and see what is the scale and what is the form of fluctuations of this sum around the limit. And of course, what do we do? We do as in probability of independent random variables. Of course, we have to subtract from the, your statistic, you have to subtract expectation. But let me remind you that in probability, it is not enough. You have to divide this sum by square root of n to get a finite, not zero, not infinity limit. Here, and it is the first surprise of random matrix theory, you divide by nothing. So the variance of your statistics is not of the order n, as I mentioned, for independent random variables. It is just bounded. And nevertheless, so all the intuition around the central limit theory, you take any book on probability, they say you, what is the central limit theorem? Okay, you divide by square root of n, you have a lot of small terms, and and the central limit theorem is a cumulative effect of all terms that organize themselves nicely for large n. But here, your fluctuations are of the order one, and nevertheless, so you have not, this is not a sum of small terms. This is a sum of terms of order one. And nevertheless, they organize themselves somehow to get a central limit theorem that these random variables converges to the Gaussian random variable with this variance. It does matter. It's a bit complicated expression. Do not pay too much attention. The most interesting thing here is that you have this, so your test function of your statistics enters in this form. And this requires certain regularity of function phi. Your test function should be, okay, not just any function like in probability. Roughly speaking, it should have just a derivative, bounded derivative, but more precisely, it should be Hardy space of certain type. So you have a certain smoothness. To get a central limit theorem, you have to ask certain smoothness of your test function. Okay, and one more thing that I would like to mention, this the fact that the variance of linear statistics, linear eigenvalue statistics, doesn't grow with n, just was used main point to explain a certain phenomenon in condensed matter known as the universality of conduction fluctuations of small metallic particles, and it was a kind of cornerstone of a certain branch of condensed matter theory, which is now known as a mesoscopic, between macroscopic and microscopic, not to mention nanoscopic. Well, and so just by looking in central limit theorem, you see that there are two new phenomena that random matrices show us relative to standard probability of scalar random variables. The first one, what is going on? So you write your statistics with subtracted expectation, and because if you divide by n, the limit exists, it is law of large numbers, you see that every term is roughly of the order one. And nevertheless, when you add this, so your variance is of the order one, as I mentioned before, and nevertheless, you have central limit theorem. That the only way to explain these things is to assume that the term, that despite that they are by amplitude, by absolute value, they are of the order one, they fluctuate strongly, and there is strong cancellation of terms that the result is still finite, despite that you have big number of terms. So the central limit theorem, the mechanism in random matrix theory is different. It is not just cumulative effect of large number of small terms. This is just a cancellation. And since you have strong cancellation, you can destroy it easily in principle. And indeed, if you take not a smooth phi, but say, for example, the indicator, when in this case, what is linear statistics? I mentioned already, it is just counting function of eigenvalues. And it can be computed explicitly. In this case, we have a the variance grows, but not linearly, just logarithmically. But it's already enough to get the central limit theorem in standard setting. So the second phenomenon that I would like to mention is that the asymptotic magnitude of the variance depends on the regularity of the smoothness of your test function, which never happened in probability. Well, let's pass to a more general class of matrices. They are called Wigner matrices. They differ from Gaussian matrices that I discussed before, just by you have still independent entries. All the entries, modulo symmetry condition, are independent. They are normalized like in the Gaussian case, but I do not assume that they are Gaussian. I just assume that they are independent. So this function f now is not necessarily Gaussian case, which corresponds to this particular form. And we're asking the same question. We're asking a question about law of large numbers first. And this was proven first by Wigner again in 58. Then there were other people. And now it's a final form, necessary sufficient condition. So you have still the same result. The counting measure divided by the number of terms converges to the limit, which is, by the way, the same as for the Gaussian case. So the Wigner law or semicircle law is a kind of universal, because like central limit theorem itself, you know, doesn't matter what random variables you are studying, provided the variance is finite, you get at the limit Gaussian distributions. Central limit here is the same. For any distribution of entries, provided that you use this normalization, you'll get the Wigner law. And the physicists often say that we have this in this case macroscopic universality, because the validity of semicircle law doesn't depend on the particular distribution of entries or your matrix. Now you pass to another thing, you pass to again to central limit theorem. You see that still you do not normalize by anything, so it is just again like before, just subtracting the expectation, and you'll get central limit theorem, but now the variance is different. So it is Gaussian part, and there is new part which contains, it's known in statistics as a cumulant, force cumulant of entries, and it is just the force moment minus three second moment, the quantity is equal zero to Gaussian variables, but in general, of course, not. So you have the variance changes again. Again, something new, because in probability, of course, if you take Gaussian random variables, they obey central limit theorem trivially. But doesn't matter what are random variables, provided that the variance is fixed, you have the same limiting law. But here is not. You have new. Your answer depends now on two moments, on the second moment and the fourth moment of entries. So it is one more new phenomenon. And this gives me just a pretext to speak about something which is ideology which is borrowed from statistical mechanics. It is known that in statistical mechanics there is a universality of phase transition. So the phase transition of second kind, they do not depend on particular material that you are studying. they depend only on basic characteristics of your material, symmetry, okay, certain very basic things. And here is, and there is a one parameter or two parameter family of materials, just one or two parameters, despite the amount of materials is infinite, which just distinguish one form of phase transition from another form of phase transition. And we say that all the materials that have the same phase transition, so-called critical indices, they belong to the same universality class. So using this terminology, we can say that the central limit theorem in random matrix theory, it consists of universality classes that depends on two parameters, second moment and fourth moments. And provided that the moments are fixed, you have your central limit theorem is already, the form is fixed because it's Gaussian distribution with this form of the variance. By the way, this notion is not new. It was in a bit different form, was introduced by well-known probabilist, and by the way, number theorist Yuri Vinnik in the 70s. He used to say that we have to classify all the limits theorems of probability theory by using certain small number of parameters, and if the parameters are fixed, you have the limiting law of a fixed form, and he proposed the term the collective theorem. It is not, I can't translate from Russian the precise terms that he used, but okay, the rough translation is collective theorem. So by using this terminology, we can say that in central limit theorem of probability of independent random variables, it consists of one parameter family of universality classes that are indexed by the variance, just variance. In the random matrix theory, we have two parameters, so we have a richer class of results. There is another kind of random, limit theorems, which date back to Emil Borel, who proved first in 1905, he proved the theorem that if you have an orthogonal matrix, just take an orthogonal group of the order n. N is big. And this is a compact group. There is a Haar measure. You can normalize the Haar measure just by the total mass is 1. And then you have an orthogonal random matrix. Because there is a measure, there is everything that you need to use the probabilistic approach. And he took just the entry 011 of his orthogonal matrix. And he proves that this quantity, which depends on n, because your group depends, you have a group un or on, and he proves that this quantity converges, obey the central limit theorem for large n. And there is a generalization of this approach, which basically due to Diaconis, that says, we take a sequence of matrices, fixed matrices, with this property, and then we consider this kind of statistics. U is random, unitary or orthogonal. A is given with this property, and it can be proven that these random variables again converges to the complex Gaussian random variable. And this is so we say that it is Borel type theorems. This is the original one, and this is a modern form. And there are many versions in several proofs. And what is going on when you pass from linear eigenvalue statistics to the Borel type situation. So we replace the trace, which is the sum of entries, we replace just by a single entry. And if you use the spectral theorem, you can write the entry in this form where lambdas the eigenvalues and psi's are eigenfunctions. And eigenvectors, they are normalized by this way, just to have a norm, L to norm 1. And that means that roughly every entry is of the order 1 over n square, n, the every square. So you have roughly here, you can forget, you believe that you can write instead of psi square, you can write 1 over n. and you arrive to normalize linear statistics. And indeed, if you about the law of large number, this is indeed the case. These things behave precisely like linear statistic divided by n, but if you pass from the law of large numbers to central to the central limit theorem setting, you have a different answer. So you have central limit theorem for the Gaussian case with a certain behavior quite similar to standard probability. So we have a law of large numbers as for traces, but the central limit theorem is different as for ID random variables. So again, you have a certain mixture of pure types of probability theory. And now I'll pass to several cases where we have no central limit theorem, we have another limiting law. And I'll start from Borel type theorem that I have just discussed for the Gaussian case. Let's now consider the general case, not necessarily the Gaussian, Wigner matrices. So these are real symmetric or Hermitian matrices with independent arbitrary distributed entries, modulo of course symmetry conditional laws. And then we find that first we are looking for the variance. The variance looks like in the Gaussian case. So the variance, you see, this limit exists. That means the variance itself is of the order 1 over n. It is standard thing, says it's probability if you take linear statistic divided by n. But its form, of course, again contains force moment like it was for linear statistics. So it is a bit different, but not too much. And we are returning to the situation of probability that the variance vanishes, and then you have a standard mechanism of the central limit theorem. So this is, excuse me, for the variance. But if you consider not a variance, but so-called characteristic function, that means you are trying to find the Fourier transform of the limiting probability law. By the way, the first modern proof of central limit theorem using the Fourier transform, using so-called characteristic function, was given by Professor Ляпунов, who was a professor of university in my city. So noblesse oblige as for myself. So you compute this function, it requires a certain work, and you obtain that there is a term which is quadratic in your variable x, so it is a kind, if this term would be one, then you have a central limit theorem. But you see that this is multiplied by the characteristic function of the entry itself. So no collective behavior, completely different. You can recover, if you have a central limit theorem, you can't recover the probability law of your initial random variable. You can recover only variance. But here you have the Fourier transform of your probability law. So you have not a collective theorem in terminology by Leibniz, but just individual theorem for every entry. And your, roughly speaking, your statistics, which is, let me remind you, just the entry of function, it is a sum of Gaussian variable, more or less universal, and just the probability law of your entry. And this is, again, a different story relative to the conventional probability. Okay, yeah. And now another case which is of interest, of considerable interest in itself. There is so far I have spoken about either Gaussian matrices or Wigner matrices, which you obtain from Gaussian case if you replace Gaussian random variables by arbitrary ones. Here, it's another way to generalize Wigner, the Gaussian distribution. You take an arbitrary function V, modulo certain conditions, and then you compute the function of your matrix. And you obtain this probability law, with the analog of the Lebesgue measure, and this is the density of your probability law with respect to this measure. And now I about Hermitian matrices is a bit simpler than real symmetric. And you can prove that this class of distributions, roughly speaking, it is disjoint with Wigner matrix. So they are two different. So if you assume the both, if you assume this form, and if you assume that the entries are independent, like in the Wigner case, you get Gaussian. So, and these are, in fact, by the way, these are two basic classes of random matrices on which we know a lot at the moment. We know a lot for Wigner matrices. We know a lot about these invariant ensembles. Sometimes they are called matrix models because they appeared in middle 70s as a toy model of string theory and gauge field theory in quantum field theory. And then they proved to be important in terrible systems, in mesoscopic, and many other fields. So now we are dealing with random matrices with strongly dependent entries, because if I take, for example, V equal lambda 4, so I have here trace of fourth power of m. Of course, if you write the fourth power of the trace, there will be all possible cross terms. So you have strongly dependent random variables already on the level of entries, and of course, even more dependent on the level of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. And so nevertheless, you have still law of large numbers here. So this is a counting measure of eigenvalues. You divide it by n. It is random variables converges to the conversion to non-random limit. But the limit now is given not a semicircle law, but it is given as a minimum of this function. So we have a link to logarithmic potential theory at the moment. So you have to write this functional. M is arbitrary non-negative measure normalized to one, total mass is one. You have to minimize this functional. The minimum infimum, in fact, exists. And the minimum is according to this assertion, is a limiting eigenvalue distribution counting measure, normalized counting measure of your eigenvalues. Okay, now, unlike the Wigner case, unlike the semicircle law, it turns out that the respective measure could, its support may consist on many intervals, and this fact, if V is not convex, as I wrote, that the support could consist in several intervals. And there is an interesting new phenomenon related to this fact that support not necessarily just an interval. And so what do we have at the moment in this case? We know that the variance still, like in the Gaussian case, doesn't grow with n of linear statistics. So we expect, again, something special, something unusual relative to the probability. But it turns out, okay, you see immediately that there is a difference. So I compute the variance. It requires a certain quite complicated things related to special type of orthogonal polynomials. So we have here the link with analysis, but I'm not about the proofs, which need a lot of asymptotic analysis, just the result. So you can prove that the variance of your eigenvalue statistics is there is a certain function which is expressed via Riemann theta functions, multidimensional, a lot of elliptic integrals, etc. But doesn't matter. What is important is that the variance has these forms. There is a function, standard function, non-random, which is quadratic in your test function. But the argument is quite peculiar because it is n, the size of your matrix, times function v is periodic. Is q minus one variables, and let me remind you what is q. Q is a number of intervals which in general not one, arbitrary finite number, at least for real analytic V. And so your support consists of q intervals. You take your limiting eigenvalue counting measure, and you compute the mass of every interval, but all but one. The first is not important, yeah? And you get a certain collection of numbers beta, and this is periodic, V is periodic function of Q minus one variables. And then you see that this function generically, because betas are just numbers, they could easily be rationally independent. If they are rationally independent, you see that your variance doesn't converge. It just oscillates more or less chaotically, because if betas, numbers beta are rationally independent, you have just, I know, this is not a periodic, just it is quasi-periodic function. And you have no limit. This is again quite new phenomenon because we used to think that used to have situation in each variance of your statistics after certain normalization, both additive and multiplicative, converges to something. Here there is no convergence, it just oscillates. And what we are going to do, we are stuck because if it oscillates, there is no well-defined asymptotic behavior. But there is an idea coming from almost periodic functions that if you have these oscillations, if you have this quasi-periodic or in general almost periodic behavior, so there is no limit. You have to do very simple things. You have to consider all possible sublimits. You have to choose all possible subsequences of n for which n beta, it is just the rational winding of the torus, converges to something. And this something we denote by x, so it is quadratic functional. And if we have number of intervals starting from 2, so generically the variance is not convergent, but we can consider all possible limits that are on the sum subset of torus. And then, okay, we have the collection of limiting variances indexed by this number. So it's already first warning that central limit theorem, if any, is going to be a bit strange because there is no a single central limit theorem. There is a family of central limit theorem indexed by this x, which in its own turn indices the subsequence for which you have a certain limit of this v. But if this is a variance, but now if you compute the characteristic function, in this case this is just not Fourier but Laplace transform. So I write statistics in the exponent, I do expectation, it will be just the Laplace transform of my probability law of statistics, and I am looking for the limit. First of all, the limit will not be standard, we have seen already. We have to choose a sequence, this is why I wrote here quotation marks. So it converges along a subsequence to a certain limit. But what is interesting, okay, there are certain formulas, but what is important for us, that if it would be central limit theorem, that this exponent phi, capital phi of test function should be quadratic in test function phi, little phi. But it is not quadratic because v itself is already its variance, yeah? It's already quadratic functional. And you have one more dependence on phi coming from a certain new object. So it is again, there is a limiting law in quotation marks, and this limiting law is not Gaussian. So we have here complete different story with respect to standard probability. And this is just an example. Okay, there are many formulas, but do not look too much. I took here the simplest possible example. I took as a statistics, you see, just lambda itself, that means that my statistics just trace of matrix, nothing else, no function. And I took very simple function, this V, very simple ensemble, but it is not Gaussian because it's lambda 4. And if the constant C is large enough, then the support consists of two symmetric disjoint intervals. And we compute the variance, and according to the general things, we see that the variance has period 2, you see? There are different limits for even and odd orders of the matrix. And now I compute the central limit theorem, I compute the Laplace transform of the limiting law, and I see that there is a quadratic part. And we are happy because, okay, if there is quadratic part in T, you see, that means that you have central limit theorem, but no, because the coefficient is not the variance, coefficient is different. And there is a part which is highly nonlinear in T. In fact, this function A is just a Jacobi elliptic function. So you have quite complicated expression. There is limiting law, but not Gaussian. And now I am passing to the last thing that I would like to discuss, which is in fact now is quite hot. Still, there is a lot of questions, but there is already a lot of results. And it is called by nickname universality. What is the subject? We are considering now the a bit different case. We are taking linear eigenvalue statistics, but the test function phi now depends on n in the following form. I take a given function phi. I choose a point on spectral axis, lambda naught, at which the counting measure has non-zero density. That means there are eigenvalues in the neighborhoods of lambda naught. And then I multiply by this factor. It, again, the rho is not important. Rho is just derivative of limiting measure. What is important is n. That means that I am changing the scale. Before, I was looking on the, by using the scale in which just limiting measure, not zero, not infinity. Now I am changing the scale. I am about a small, a 1 over n neighborhood. Oh my God, just a moment. 1 over n neighborhood of a given point. This is why we call it local asymptotic regime. And I just would like to remark that this quantity, n times rho on lambda naught, it is roughly typical distances between eigenvalues in the neighborhood of this point lambda naught. So we say that this is just typical spacing. And that means that we are now about the probability properties of the spacings between nearest neighbors eigenvalues. So we take an eigenvalue, we find the next one, say, to the right. And this will be random variable since eigenvalues are random. And you are interested in the properties of this of this random variable, which, by the way, enters a lot of applied fields. There are many fields in which it is important quantity. And I'm trying to find now the same, the generating functional, but for this special test function. And the answer, which requires a considerable amount of work, is the following. So it turns out that this limit, when n tends to infinity, I forgot here the limit sign. So it is given, it is a Fredholm determinant of a certain integral operator. Okay, it doesn't matter what is Fredholm determinant. It is just, you have an integral operator here, where psi is related to phi in this form, but just you can, the, because, so the expression rather complicate, but what is important, let me remind you that I am about the case where I have quite general class of matrices. So, here, you see, there is an arbitrary function V. You have an arbitrary functional argument, yeah? And the result, I'm back, excuse me. The result of this limiting transition, if you take this special form of test function, the result doesn't depend on V. V is nowhere here. So the V enters only in rho. So if I use the scale that depends on the particular matrix, on that scale, you have the answer which depends on anything. This formula is universal. This is why we are saying that it is universal distribution, provided that you use appropriate variables to measure your quantity, yes? And from a point of view of limiting theorem, here we have the quite definite answer. Everything is okay, limit exists, but it is apparently not quadratic. So again, we have now limiting law, not like before along a certain subsequence, but genuine limiting law, but it is not Gaussian, it is completely different. Quite, in fact, this is a series in function phi. So, but now we are close to the following thing. I would like now to consider the quantity, which is in fact this Laplace transform, but of a special function. I take an interval. Yes, I take an interval 0s, and I use as a my test function, I use its indicator. And it's easy to see that this quantity is quite easy to understand, because it is just the probability that all the eigenvalues are outside the interval between lambda naught and just a bit more, lambda naught plus s, which is my new variables, and divided by the same thing, by typical distance between eigenvalues. So I ask myself, what is this? It's called gap probability. What is the limiting gap probability? And I repeat, it is of its own, of course, interest, but it is in quantum field theory, in integral systems. In many fields, you need this quantity. And one more, okay, why, well, one more utility of this quantity is that if you it is easy to understand that if you take the second derivative of this gap probability with respect to rescaled lengths of the interval, this will be just the probability density of spacing of just you have a subsequent adjusted eigenvalues, and you, as I mentioned before, you ask in what is the probability distribution. So the probability distribution of spacings between eigenvalues is given by just the second derivative. And it was computed in the middle 60s that if you, about the Gaussian ensemble, this limit exists, and it is given again by the same Fredholm determinant. And the motivation of this calculation was again due to Wigner, that who asked the question coming from experimental nuclear physics, what is the probability distribution of spacing between eigenvalues? Because I see it was experimental finding of 48, I believe, it was in Soviet Union in the United States. They found that the nuclear spectra, they are quite peculiar. I'll show you now what are they. So you see, this histogram is a just experimental fact. These are energy levels of this element, europi. Yes, you have 180 spacings, that means 109 levels, energy levels, and you compute just difference between levels, that means spacings, and you do the histogram. Now, this is a curve which is precisely given by that formula. And you see that correspondence, yeah? But if on the contrary, you assume that eigenvalues or your matrix, they are just independent random variables, then it is easy to find the distribution of spacing. It is just one line calculation. And you find that it is a Poisson distribution. So you see that apparently the random matrices give much, much more precise fit than Poisson distribution. And this is these are corresponding formulas. Poisson distribution is just this formula. It's very simple. And this distribution, which brings the name of people who first found it, it is different. You can't find explicit formula for this Fredholm determinant, but Wigner, again, in early 50s, proposed the so-called Wigner surmise. It turns out that the formula is correct for small s, for large s, but in general it is not correct, even concrete form, explicit form, nor even these constants, but nevertheless it gives very nice fit. So these are spacings, and now let me show you the picture of spacing, okay, of in the spectra, but just a collection of numbers, and you see the difference. So let's start from Poisson distribution. If you have just independent points on the line, and you compute spacing differences between just spacing between nearest neighbors, you see this picture. There are big gaps, you see, and this is why physicists sometimes say that you see the independent random variables. They are clusters. To zero. I mentioned this on the, roughly speaking, already on the one of the first slides. So eigenvalues, they repel one another. Eigenvalues of random matrices, they do not want to live. They are quite individualistic. They are not from socialistic countries. They are completely capitalistic things. They are quite individualistic, yeah? So, and we see this here. So we have already more or less, what does it mean repelling? If they repel one another, they would like to live not too far away, not too close away, somewhere in between. And we see this for the spectra of this europi. And there is another completely different subject. You take a stadium for billiard, Sinai billiard. This is a classical example of dynamical system. And now you consider so-called quantum chaotic setting. You take Laplacian operator in this domain, in this billiard, with zero boundary condition, you compute eigenvalues, and you compute spacing between eigenvalues. And this is now the field known as a quantum cohomology, and you see that it's more or less uniformly distributed. There are no clusters. There are no gaps. And this is why random matrices used to be important in quantum cohomology, because they explain a lot of things. Now, next thing, it is completely different field. Let's take zeros of zeta function, of Riemann zeta function, one of the biggest, maybe biggest problem of math, whole math, not only number theory. Yeah? And it was found that the, so you see it's again more or less uniform, and it was found in 70s by Montgomery that it's still not explained why, but he found that the spacing between zeros of zeta function are quite well fitted to the random, to this curve, to the curve that I showed before, to the Wigner Dyson meta distribution. You have this curve. People are speculating that there is an old idea by George Poe and David Hilbert that we can easily prove, okay, we can prove Riemann hypothesis if you find a certain self-adjoint operator, because the zeros, they are on the critical line, so there is a self-adjoint operator on this line, and zeros of zeta function are eigenvalues of this operator. This operator still not found. Okay, there are some people claiming that they found the operator. There is Alan Kohn that's saying that I found the operator. Indeed, he indicated a certain operator that could serve. The operator is very simple, roughly speaking, the first derivative, but the set, the manifold on which the operator is defined, completely horrible. So you can't make spectral analysis. So still, the problem is open. Yeah? But nevertheless, this is a kind of confirmation of the conjecture, of Riemann conjecture, little hypothesis that zeros of zeta function, they behave like eigenvalues of random matrices. And now the enormous calculation, the recent one is how much 10 to power 20 zeros are computed. And if you take spacings of these zeros high enough on the critical line, you'll see this, and you can fit with this Wigner Dyson distribution, and fit is quite well. So a natural question after that this form of the spacing distribution via corresponding Fredholm determinant should be universal. It shouldn't depend on a particular matrix in question. And this conjecture was formulated by Dyson in 73 in a bit vague form. And now we know the proof for two cases, for invariant ensembles that I mentioned. First, first proof was given in 97, then in 98, then another proof more recent. And there is another class of ensembles, these Wigner ensembles, for which it was proven quite recently by two groups of people. Laszlo. So this is Erdős and Yao, but not Peter Erdős, but Laszlo Erdős, and Yao also, there are two Yao, as we know. This is not a geometry, this is a mathematical physicist, who is in Harvard now. And another group is Tao and Wu. Almost simultaneously, they proved the universality, that means this Fredholm determinant form for Wigner ensembles. And it is a bit annoying that the proof for these two classes of ensembles is completely different. So we use completely different techniques, despite the phenomenon itself, the final formula is the same. And so now there is a general case we are trying to prove this in general case, but it is hard things because first, you see, the conjecture itself is quite vague. We are saying more or less arbitrary random matrix should obey the universality law. But of course we have to specify this corresponding random matrix is distribution, and now we do not know what is the precise class of matrices for which it is known, but maybe it is not most serious. The most serious is the proofs, existing proofs are completely different. While, for example, it was, by the way, the same story in statistical mechanics. Universality is known since 30s, and there were many particular proofs, but only in 70s, Kenneth Wilson found the general approach and proved the universality of phase transition. For this reason, he invented so-called renormalization group, which is quite efficient in many fields of theoretical mathematical physics. But unfortunately, we have not yet still this kind of tool. And okay, this is our hope that we'll find a proof which applies to large, first larger classes of matrices, but is more or less in the framework of the unique ideology. Thank you very much. Oh, a lot, but I didn't discuss here. The maximum eigenvalue, first of all, you know, since you are computing, for first thing that you compute, this is eigenvalue counting measure, and eigenvalue counting measure, it is the number of eigenvalues divided by n. So the limit is just an interval, this is a semicircle law. You can suspect that outside the interval there is little o of eigenvalues, but no. Maximum eigenvalues converges to the edge of this support. And now we know, okay, we know since middle 90s we have a corresponding distribution which is called Tresividum and a lot of things around. So it is more or less well studied. Well studied, yeah. This is another story. In a way it is simpler and more complex. If you're about maximum eigenvalues, yeah, or generally. Yeah, but now there is a certain progress. Just a few years ago, the distribution was found. There is a kind of equations you have to solve, functional equation. It is not as simple as Wigner law, but nevertheless there is a formula. This was a recent paper by Zaituni and Guioni. So it is more or less known. But for universality and other things, local regimes still completely open.